OK，那我们开始下一个talk。那下一个是由英特尔的Arduino Program给大家介绍一下非意识性内存在适配上的应用。OK，let's welcome to introduce you the
Hi all, good morning. Sorry for not able to speak in native language. Myself Anoop and my colleague Ram, we are working with Intel India Bangalore team. So today we will try to cover our recent work for the optimization or the changes for HBase, especially for the new persistent memory types coming up. So first we will see how HBase looks like, the present model today, or it will try to cover the problem statement, what the problem we are trying to address or solve and also the region replica feature. And then towards we will see the persistent memory technology and how the optimization, what we are trying to do, and some of the performance numbers what we got on the changes what we are doing. So as we all know how HBase, especially the write path works, we know we have region servers and regions in that, in which we have mem store, the data being written, it's first put it into a sorted map, and we know that we have the local labs, the local allocation buffer to avoid the memory fragmentation. So we will be having by default 2 MB sized labs in the RAM area, and the data, the cell data will be there, and whereas the cell object, the POJOS, will be sitting in the sorted map, the CSLM. And also we have the write ahead logs. Whenever the writes are happening, we will write to wall to recover from the possible server crashes. The walls are sitting in the HDFS. It is a HDFS files, and then when it reaches the flush size by default 128 MB, we will try to flush it as a H file into HDFS. Okay, this is the present model looks like, and later on we will be having the compactions anyway, and the role of walls is when a server is crashing mainly. So we have to replay the wall. So the regions in the failed server will be allocated to some other region servers by the master load balancer. And then we will go for splitting the wall. Okay, we will split the wall and replay the wall and get the, means what the possible missed data into the new regions mem store. Okay, so as we know, when the replay of the wall is happening, the data is temporarily not available. So if we are trying to get those data, the region itself is not up yet because it's still in the opening space. Okay, so it depends on how many regions were there. The wall split might take some more time. For actually, first it has to split and write it as temporary, like per region, this thing, wall files, split files, and then it has to again read that and replay into the newly opened region. So sometimes it even takes few minutes to get it back. So we often hear this complaint. Even in last year conference also, we had a discussion around this in the roundtable discussion. And also one more thing is that with respect to the write ahead log, we have the more and more HDFS interactions at that point of time. So we in the first talk stack already mentioned one point, the recent work for cloud. We will be able to write the H files to one file system and the wall to another file system, and that the need of that particular feature was mainly towards the cloud implementations. In the cloud, especially in AWS and all, they try to write the H files, the actual data, into S3. But going wall into S3 is out of question. So means the you cannot imagine the latency then. So still we need wall in something like a much lower latency space like HDFS only. So this alone put one more requirement for the HBase cluster that you must have something like an HDFS cluster again. Just for wall itself, it is required. Okay. In another issue 19020, the Salesforce guys are trying to actually, I think it is integrated already, instead of HFlush trying to put the HSync, use the HSync API in HDFS itself for the wall writes. So by default, it uses HFlush only. Means the data from the region server is going to the data node process only, and there it will be just added to the in-memory. It's not actually persisted to the disk or SSDs or wherever it be, wherever your wall is going to sit. So if the RS is dying and all your data nodes in a very unlucky event are dying, it is possible that still you can lose the data because it is not at actually synced to the disk. So instead of that, there is another HSync API, and they actually, you can configure now for the wall to use, instead of HFlush, HSync can be used. But again, the issue is latency, you will suffer. It will be much higher latency. So this is about the present model, how it looks like today. So the main point we were trying to address is the availability part. So whenever a possible crash of a server is there, during that time, the data is not really available if somebody is looking to read that data. So in HBase 1.x versions, we have already one feature, region replica. Okay. So every region will be there. The primary region will be there in one region server. And there can be a replica region sitting in another region server. And we have the H files in HDFS anyway. And both the regions can refer to the same H files. Okay, and even the memstore data, that also can be replicated. There is one configuration is there. If it is turned on, the data, when the client will write the data only to the primary, and in an async way, it will be replicated using the wall read and replication, the normal cluster to cluster replication way itself. It will be replicated to the replica region also. So this is already available feature. And whenever there is a primary down, the data can be read from the replica. But the catch line there is, it's not consistent data. It's only a timeline consistency. Why? Because we are going via the normal async, normal way of wall-based replication, which is getting consistent in an eventual way. Okay, so with that kind of selected use cases, yeah, it's fine. You can say an eventual consistent data can be available using the region replica feature. Okay, so this is the present situation. We have a problem statement and we have some kind of a solution towards that using the region replica. But there is a but. It's only for some of the use cases. And with respect at this regard, we actually thought about that, and we tried to make use of some of the new hardware technology, and we were thinking whether we can address this issue. So that is the persistent memory technology, and in the persistent memory technology, the data, whatever we are writing, it is persisting, but it's not like a block device where you have to write or read in terms of pages and blocks. Where you will have much more latency. It's not like that. It's like the processor can read or write to that particular area just like it is dealing with the DRAM. So using the processor load and store instructions. And the processor, that memory accessing APIs, okay? And with respect to that, 2 years back, I forgot exactly when, there was a new technology being introduced, the 3D cross point, and in which first some SSDs came up, and then Intel tried to announce actually the new hardware which will be coming to the market soon. We call it Apache Pass, AEP. It's a persistent memory, and it's kind of DRAM where the data can be directly accessed using the processor instructions without any page caching or anything, any use of any page cache or anything. It's direct like DRAM, how you refer some bytes and you read it back. Okay, and the memory, it can be persistent also. Once you write to that particular area, you are sure that it can be persisted, and whenever there is a restart of the server, you can regain that data, even if there is a crash. Okay, and there were few libraries. These are some C libraries, NVML, PMDK libraries, which were developed at first for this particular kind of persistent memory hardware, and especially for the Apache Pass, and even some Java wrappers were around this. So when we tried to think about the how to solve this problem, this was the present hardware things, whatever were available before us, and the software libraries, and then we tried to solve it some way using the new hardware, and try to address the issue of what is that? Two issues at hand, the data availability part, and the second is, especially when we are going more towards the cloud, the need of wall is some kind of what issue maker, how to solve that. And present that, what is that, the architecture or the solution, what we thought about, I invite Ram to continue with those slides. Ram?
Hi, everyone. I'll continue from the current architecture that we are trying to make use of for this wireless persistence. So as you know, the internal of how the write path works with the underlying MS lab was explained in the previous slide, and we are all aware of it. So this is nothing but we will be replacing the off heap byte buffers that are underlying these MS labs with the byte buffers that are created out of AEP hardware. So this AEP is nothing but it allows you to create a file in that device, and it is an mapped file. But the difference is, as he said, it does not bring the file into the RAM. You can directly access it from the device without bringing it to the RAM. So that is the specialty of this particular device. So using those Java wrappers, we create these byte buffers, and those byte buffers directly reside on the AEP device. So internally, if you see the MS lab structure, which was actually pointing to the off heap memory area, will now be pointing to the AEP area. So that is the major difference, and the only difference that you can see with respect to how the MS lab and the memstores are working. So here again, we start writing to this primary region, and those MS labs are like create cells, and from their cells are again populated into the CSLM map. So that part remains the same. So now, as we know that we already have the region replica feature, so we try to make use of the same region replica feature. So every region will have its own replicas. So it is again configurable. Say you can have 2 to 3 replicas as based on your use case. So if you see here, we do synchronous replication whenever we do a write. So any mutation that happens to the primary, we do it synchronously, we replicate it to the secondary replicas. So this is the, and all the secondary replicas are also backed up by similar AEP structures. So you will perform, the write path is like, the HBase will form a pipeline from primary to secondary to tertiary and all the replicas. And once all the replicas gets the data, then we say the right mutation as a successful one. So we again have the concept of minimum replicas, how to take care of those things. Like if you have 5 replicas and your minimum replica is 3, at least 3 writes should be done for across the replicas. Only then the mutation is considered to be a successful one. So here the main point is we remove the write ahead lock totally. So directly writes to the primary and then replication. So the advantage is if your primary is down, you already have replicated the data to your secondary and tertiary in a consistent way. So you can always switch over to your secondary or tertiary replica for any reads. So at any point of time, the read that happens on the primary, the data that you are going to see is going to be the same when you read from the primary, secondary or tertiary. So faster switch over to replicas, you can easily rebuild your data in case of a full cluster crash. So you have all your nodes down and you have to bring back the data. So reading from AEP and building the memstore structure is going to be much faster than reading a val, then creating the split files, then again rebuilding the memstore map. So it's going to be multiple times faster than your write ahead log way. For more details, you can see the Jira number 2003. Okay, so coming to the advantages of having more memory and what are the disadvantages that we can see. See, generally with AEP, the main purpose of AEP is to have more memory, so which is like outside your DRAM. So apart from your DRAM, you can give lots and lots of memory to your process. That's the advantage with AEP. So what you get is, you get more memory, memstore size, and the global memstore size also can be sufficiently increased. So more data is in memory, so you'll start flushing much lesser. And when you do lesser flushes, so lesser compactions, and then you have less I/O. So the reads are going to be from memory. But the disadvantage is when you go with more memory, then you have the Java heaps related issues. And then adding more and more cells to the CSLM is again an issue that was covered in the first talk. And that is where the CCS map and the compaction memstore comes in. And then when you have more, when you have val, then the more the val, then the bigger the time for MTTR, the mean time to recover. So that's why we come up with this off-heap memory and off-heap memstores, and then we have the compacting memstore and the CCS map. And for the val problem, we have this AEP solution where you avoid val, and so you have better recovery, and the MTTR is much better. So combining AEP with the off-heap writes or the compacting memstore together will give you an end-to-end solution on how to manage bigger memories on AEP. So these are some of the performance analysis that we did. So I would like to cover one point here. So since we do a synchronous replication from the primary to the replicas, the major portion of the performance is actually a problem when you try to add more and more cells to the CSLM. So that is the memstore map. So what we do is in primary, yeah, we have to add it to the CSLM directly. But when we actually do it to the secondary and the tertiary replicas, we only copy the data to the MS lab and asynchronously we add it to the memstore map. So this helps greatly in reducing the latency. If not, if you are not doing it, because the CSLM addition is the actual pain-taking factor, the performance hit happens in that particular area. So when we do this copy to the MS lab area on the secondary, we don't wait for it to be added to the CSLM. We do it asynchronously. So every mutation is added asynchronously to a CSLM. And that is how we advance the MVCC read points. So that is how we ensure that there is a strong consistency. So till it is added to CSLM, we don't advance the MVCC read points also. So coming to some of the initial performance analysis that we did on a four-node cluster with 100 client threads using performance evaluation tool and 250 GB of data. So this is a comparison where we have val with the HDFS replication of 3 as the factor, and the first one is the valless replication. So where we have one primary and followed by two replicas. So you can see like the average throughput is approximately 2x compared to the val cases. And the more important thing is your latency is almost consistent from the beginning to the end of the experiment. But when you take with the val, as and when your data increases, your latency actually comes down. Say it's not consistent. So more the data, your latency is slowly going down. But in the case of val, it's not like that. It's going to be 100% consistent. And other main key factor is, so as Anup was explaining, the difference between H-sync and H-flush. So when you do with H-sync with val, your throughput is going to take a major hit because that H-sync is internally going to take time because it ensures only then the data is really flushed into the disk. But in case of val, you write the data, it is 100% guaranteed that it is flushed into the persistent memory. It's not that you have a difference between like the val case where you have H flush and H-sync. So that is a major difference between the val case and the valless case in terms of performance analysis. Here the diagram shows the difference between valless and val, and this is with H-flush, not with H-sync. H-sync, maybe the latency is much more lower than what we are showing here. So this is with respect to reads. So as you know, whenever the primary is down, what you need for the meantime to recover, quick recovery is like at least your reads should be available and it should also be consistent. The earlier region replica case, the problem was though you can switch over, the thing is you cannot be sure that it is the latest consistent data. But here with val case, since we are always consistent with respect to what we write, we get the latest consistent data as the result. So if you see for the same four node cluster with random reads, we tried with different zookeeper session timeouts. So you can see like almost the max latency, if you see, it is all 44 times to 104x times faster than what you get with the val case. Because in the val case, first thing is after the node is down, you have to wait for the zookeeper session timeout to be completed. And only then the master knows that the node is actually down. And then it will internally try to replay the val. And after the region is available is where you really get the data. But here, we can be sure that internally, if you are trying to say the process is down, the primary process is down, but still the zookeeper has not been notified. And your client is trying to hit that particular region server and it sees the process is down. So internally you can have mechanisms to switch over immediately to the replica regions. And that's where you get this better time latency. So internally we have configurations where we can say like how much time should I wait before I don't get a reply from the primary to switch over to the replica regions. So considering that, we see a very significant difference with the current val implementations. regions. So considering that, we see a very significant difference with the current VAL implementation and the VAL-less case.
Regions.